Hi, Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents From Bacteria to Bach and Back, The Evolution of Minds, by Daniel C. Dennett, read by Tom Perkins. Preface. I started trying to think seriously about the evolution of the human mind when I was a graduate student in philosophy in Oxford in 1963 and knew almost nothing about either evolution or the human mind. In those days, philosophers weren't expected to know about science, and even the most illustrious philosophers of mind were largely ignorant of work in psychology, neuroanatomy, and neurophysiology. The terms cognitive science and neuroscience would not be coined for more than a decade. The fledgling enterprise, dubbed Artificial Intelligence by John McCarthy in 1956, was attracting attention, but few philosophers had ever touched a computer, whirring mysteriously in an air-conditioned prison guarded by technicians. So it was the perfect time for an utterly untrained amateur like me to get an education in all these fields. A philosopher who asked good questions about what they were doing, instead of telling them why, in principle, their projects were impossible, was apparently such a refreshing novelty that a sterling cadre of pioneering researchers took me in, gave me informal tutorials, and sent me alerts about whom to take seriously and what to read, all the while being more forgiving of my naive misunderstandings than they would have been had I been one of their colleagues or graduate students. Today, there are dozens, hundreds of young philosophers who do have solid interdisciplinary training in cognitive science, neuroscience, and computer science, and they are rightly held to much higher standards than I was. Some of them are my students, and even grand students, but other philosophers of my generation jumped into the deep end, often with more training than I, and have their own distinguished flocks of students making progress on the cutting edge, either as interdisciplinary philosophers or as philosophically trained scientists with labs of their own. They are professionals, and I am still an amateur, but by now a well-informed amateur who gets invited to give lectures and participate in workshops and visit labs all over the world, where I continue my education, having more fun than I ever imagined an academic life could provide. I consider this book to be, among other things, my grateful attempt to pay my tuition for all that instruction. This is what I think I've learned. A lot of it is still very conjectural, philosophical, out on a limb. I claim that it is the sketch, the backbone of the best scientific theory to date of how our minds came into existence, how our brains work all their wonders, and especially how to think about minds and brains without falling into alluring philosophical traps. That is a controversial claim, of course, and I am eagerly looking forward to engaging with the reactions of both scientists and philosophers, and the amateurs who often have the most perceptive comments of all. Daniel Dennett, North Andover, Massachusetts, March 28, 2016. Part 1. Turning Our World Upside Down. 1. Introduction. Welcome to the jungle. How come there are minds? And how is it possible for minds to ask and answer this question? The short answer is that minds evolved and created thinking tools that eventually enabled minds to know how minds evolved, and even to know how these tools enabled them to know what minds are. What thinking tools? The simplest, on which all the others depend in various ways, are spoken words, followed by reading, writing, and arithmetic, followed by navigation and map-making, apprenticeship practices, and all the concrete devices for extracting and manipulating information that we have invented. Compass, telescope, microscope, camera, computer, the internet, and so on. These in turn fill our lives with technology and science, permitting us to know many things not known by any other species. We know there are bacteria, dogs don't, dolphins don't, chimpanzees don't, even bacteria don't know there are bacteria. Our minds are different. It takes thinking tools to understand what bacteria are, and we're the only species so far endowed with an elaborate kit of thinking tools. That's the short answer. And stripped down to the bare generalities, it shouldn't be controversial. But lurking in the details are some surprising, even shocking, implications that aren't yet well understood or appreciated. There is a winding path leading through a jungle of science and philosophy, from the initial bland assumption that we people are physical objects, obeying the laws of physics, to an understanding of our conscious minds. The path is strewn with difficulties, both empirical and conceptual, and there are plenty of experts who vigorously disagree on how to handle these problems. I have been struggling through these thickets and quagmires for over 50 years, and I have found a path that takes us all the way to a satisfactory and satisfying account of how the magic of our minds is accomplished without any magic. But it is neither straight nor easy. It is not the only path on offer, but it is the best, most promising to date, as I hope to show. It does require anyone who makes the trip to abandon some precious intuitions. But I think that I have at last found ways of making the act of jettisoning these obvious truths not just bearable, but even delightful. It turns your head inside out, in a way, yielding some striking new perspectives on what is going on. But you do have to let go of some ideas that are dear to many. There are distinguished thinkers who have disagreed with my proposals over the years, and I expect some will continue to find my new forays as outrageous as my earlier efforts. But now I'm beginning to find good company along my path, new support for my proposed landmarks, and new themes for motivating the various strange inversions of reasoning I will invite you to execute. Some of these will be familiar to those who have read my earlier work, but these ideas have been repaired, strengthened, and redesigned somewhat to do heavier lifting than heretofore. The new ones are just as counterintuitive at first as the old ones, and trying to appreciate them without following my convoluted path is likely to be forlorn, as I know from many years of trying and failing to persuade people piecemeal. Here is a warning list of some of the hazards to comfortable thinking you will meet on my path, and I don't expect you to get all of them on the first encounter. 1. Darwin's strange inversion of reasoning. 2. Reasons without reasoners. 3. Competence without comprehension. 4. Turing's strange inversion of reasoning. 5. Information as design worth stealing. 6. Darwinism about Darwinism. 7. Feral neurons. 8. Words striving to reproduce. 9. The evolution of the evolution of culture. 10. Hume's strange inversion of reasoning. 11. Consciousness as a user illusion. 12. The age of post-intelligent design. Information as design worth stealing? Don't you know about Shannon's mathematical theory of information? Feral neurons? As contrasted with what? Domesticated neurons? Are you serious? Consciousness as an illusion? Are you kidding? If it weren't for the growing ranks of like-minded theorists, well-informed scientists and philosophers who agree with at least large portions of my view and have deeply contributed to it, I'd no doubt lose my nerve and decide that I was the one who's terminally confused. And, of course, it's possible that our bold community of enthusiasts are deluding each other. But let's find out how it goes before we chance a verdict. I know how easy, how tempting it is to ignore these strange ideas or dismiss them without a hearing when first encountered, because I have often done so myself. They remind me of those puzzles that have a retrospectively obvious solution that you initially dismiss with the snap judgment, "It can't be that," or don't even consider it is so unpromising. For someone who has often accused others of mistaking failures of imagination for insights into necessity, it is embarrassing to recognize my own lapses in this regard, But having stumbled upon, or been patiently shown, new ways of couching the issues, I am eager to pass on my newfound solutions to the big puzzles about the mind. All 12 of these ideas, and the background to render them palatable, will be presented in roughly the order heard previously. Roughly because I have found that some of them defy straightforward defense. You can't appreciate them until you see what they can get you. But you can't use them until you appreciate them, so you have to start with partial expositions that sketch the idea and then circle back once you've seen it in action to drive home the point. The book's argument is composed of three strenuous exercises of imagination. Turning our world upside down, following Darwin and Turing, then evolving evolution into intelligent design, and finally, turning our minds inside out. The foundation must be carefully secured in the first 5 chapters if it is to hold our imaginations in place for the second feat. The next 8 chapters delve into the empirical details of the evolution of minds and language as they appear from our inverted perspective. This allows us to frame new questions and sketch new answers, which then sets the stage for the hardest inversion of all, seeing what consciousness looks like from the new perspective. It's a challenging route, but there are stretches where I review familiar material to make sure everybody is on the same page. Those who know these topics better than I do can jump ahead if they wish, or they can use my treatments of them to gauge how much they should trust me on the topics they don't know much about. Let's get started. A bird's eye view of the journey. Life has been evolving on this planet for close to 4 billion years. The first 2 billion years, roughly, were spent optimizing the basic machinery for self-maintenance, energy acquisition and reproduction, and the only living things were relatively simple single-celled entities, bacteria or their cousins, archaea, the prokaryotes. Then an amazing thing happened. 2 different prokaryotes, each with its own competences and habits due to its billions of years of independent evolution, collided. Collisions of this sort presumably happened countless numbers of times, but on at least one occasion, one cell engulfed the other, and instead of destroying the other and using the parts as fuel or building materials, eating it, in other words, it let it go on living, and by dumb luck found itself fitter, more competent in some ways that mattered than it had been as an unencumbered soloist. This was perhaps the first successful instance of technology transfer, a case of 2 different sets of competences honed over eons of independent R&D, research and development, being united into something bigger and better. We read almost every day of Google or Amazon or General Motors gobbling up some little startup company to get its hands on their technological innovations and savvy, advances in R&D that are easier to grow in cramped quarters than in giant corporations. But the original exploitation of this tactic gave evolution its first great boost. Random mergers don't always work out that way. In fact, they almost never work out that way, but evolution is a process that depends on amplifying things that almost never happen. For instance, mutation in DNA almost never occurs, not once in a billion copyings, but evolution depends on it. Moreover, the vast majority of mutations are either deleterious or neutral, or fortuitously good mutation almost never happens. But evolution depends on those rarest of rare events. Speciation, the process in which a new species is generated when some members get isolated from their parent population and wander away in genetic space to form a new gene pool, is an exceedingly rare event. But the millions or billions of species that have existed on this planet each got their start with an event of speciation. Every birth in every lineage is a potential initiation of a speciation event. But speciation almost never happens, not once in a million births. In the case we are considering, the rare improvement that resulted from the fortuitous collision of a bacterium and an archaeon had a life-changing sequel. Being fitter, This conjoined duo reproduced more successfully than the competition, and every time it divided in two, the bacterial way of reproducing, both daughter cells included an offspring of the original guest. Henceforth, their fates were joined, symbiosis, in one of the most productive episodes in the history of evolution. This was endosymbiosis because one of the partners was literally inside the other. Unlike the side-by-side ecosymbiosis of clownfish and sea anemone, or fungus and algae in lichens. Thus was born the eukaryotic cell, which, having more working parts, was more versatile than its ancestors, simple prokaryotic cells, such as bacteria. Over time, these eukaryotes grew much larger, more complex, more competent. Better, the EU in eukaryotic is like the EU in euphonious, eulogy, and eugenics. It means good. Eukaryotes were the key ingredient to make possible multicellular life forms of all varieties. To a first approximation, every living thing big enough to be visible to the naked eye is a multicellular eukaryote. We are eukaryotes, and so are sharks, birds, trees, mushrooms, insects, worms, and all the other plants and animals, all direct descendants of the original eukaryotic cell. This eukaryotic revolution paved the way for another great transition, the Cambrian explosion, more than half a billion years ago, which saw the sudden arrival of a bounty of new life forms. Then came what I call the MacCready explosion, after the late great Paul MacCready, visionary engineer and creator of the gossamer albatross, among other green marvels. Unlike the Cambrian diversification, which occurred over several million years, about 530 million years ago, the MacCready explosion occurred in only about 10,000 years, or 500 human generations. According to MacCready's calculations, at the dawn of human agriculture, 10,000 years ago, the worldwide human population, plus their livestock and pets, was only about 0.1% of the terrestrial vertebrate biomass. We're leaving out insects, other invertebrates, and all marine animals. Today, by his estimation, it is 98%. Most of that is cattle. His reflections on this amazing development are worth quoting. Over billions of years, on a unique sphere, chance has painted a thin covering of life, complex, improbable, wonderful, and fragile. Suddenly, we humans have grown in population, technology, and intelligence to a position of terrible power. We now wield the paintbrush. There have been other relatively sudden changes on our planet. Mass extinctions, such as the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction about 66 million years ago that doomed the dinosaurs. But the MacCready explosion is certainly one of the fastest major biological changes ever to occur on Earth. It is still going on and picking up speed. We can save the planet or extinguish all life on the planet, something no other species can even imagine. It might seem obvious that the order of MacCready's three factors, population, technology, and intelligence, should be reversed. First, our human intelligence created the technology, including agriculture, that then permitted the population boom. But, as we shall see, evolution is typically an interwoven fabric of coevolutionary loops and twists. In surprising ways, our so-called native intelligence depends on both our technology and our numbers. Our human minds are strikingly different from the minds of all other species, many times more powerful and more versatile. The long answer of how we came to have such remarkable minds is beginning to come into focus. The British biologist D'Arcy Thompson famously said, "Everything is the way it is because it got that way." Many of the puzzles, or mysteries, or paradoxes of human consciousness evaporate once you ask how they could possibly have arisen, and actually try to answer the question. I mention that because some people marvel at the question and then answer it by saying, "It is an impenetrable mystery," or "God did it." They may in the end be right, of course, but given the fabulous bounty of thinking tools recently put at our disposal and hardly used yet, this is a strikingly premature surrender. It may not be defeatist, it may be defensive. Some people would like to persuade the curious to keep their hands off the beloved mysteries, not realizing that a mystery solved is even more ravishing than the ignorant fantasies it replaces. There are some people who have looked hard at scientific explanations and disagree. To their taste, ancient myths of fiery chariots, warring gods, worlds hatching from serpent eggs, evil spells, and enchanted gardens are more delightful and worthy of attention than any rigorous, predictive scientific story. You can't please everybody. This love of mystery is just one of the potent imagination blockers standing in our way as we attempt to answer the question of how come there are minds, and, as I already warned, our path will have to circle back several times, returning to postponed questions that couldn't be answered until we had a background that couldn't be provided, until we had the tools, which couldn't be counted on until we knew where they came from. A cycle that gradually fills in the details of a sketch that won't be convincing until we can reach a vantage point from which we can look back and see how all the parts fit together. Douglas Hofstadter's book, I Am a Strange Loop, describes a mind composing itself in cycles of processing that loop around, twisting and feeding on themselves, creating exuberant reactions to reflections, to reminders, to reevaluations that generate novel structures, ideas, fantasies, theories, and, yes, thinking tools to create still more. Read it. It will take your imagination on a roller coaster ride, and you will learn a lot of surprising truths. My story in this book is of the larger strange looping process, composed of processes composed of processes, that generated minds like Hofstadter's and Bach's and Darwin's out of nothing but molecules, made of atoms, made of... Since the task is cyclical, we have to begin somewhere in the middle and go around several times. The task is made difficult by a feature it doesn't share with other scientific investigations of processes, in cosmology, geology, biology, and history, for instance. People care so deeply what the answers are that they have a very hard time making themselves actually consider the candidate answers objectively. For instance, some readers may already be silently shaking their heads over a claim I just made. Our human minds are strikingly different from the minds of all other species, many times more powerful and more versatile. Am I really that prejudiced? Am I a species chauvinist who actually thinks human minds are that much more wonderful than the minds of dolphins and elephants and crows and bonobos and the other clever species whose cognitive talents have recently been discovered and celebrated? Isn't this a barefaced example of the fallacy of human exceptionalism? Some listeners may be ready to throw their headphones across the room, and others may just be unsettled by my politically incorrect lapse. It's amusing, to me at least, that human exceptionalism provokes equal outrage in opposite directions. Some scientists and many animal lovers deplore it as an intellectual sin of the worst kind, scientifically ill-informed, an ignoble vestige of the bad old days when people routinely thought that all dumb animals were put on this planet for our use and amusement. Our brains are made of the same neurons as bird brains, they note, and some animal brains are just as large and just as smart in their own species-specific ways as ours. The more you study the actual circumstances and behaviors of animals in the wild, the more you appreciate their brilliance. Other thinkers, particularly in the arts and humanities and social sciences, consider the denial of human exceptionalism to be myopic, doctrinaire, scientism at its worst. Of course our minds are orders of magnitude more powerful than the cleverest animal mind. No animal creates art, writes poetry, devises scientific theories, builds spaceships, navigates the oceans, or even tames fire. This provokes the retort, What about the elegantly decorated bowers built by bowerbirds, the political subtlety of chimpanzees, the navigational prowess of whales and elephants and migrating birds, the virtuoso song of the nightingale, the language of the vervet monkeys, and even the honeybees? Which invites the response that these animal marvels are paltry accomplishments when compared with the genius of human artists, engineers, and scientists. Some years ago, I coined the terms romantic and killjoy to refer to the sides of this intense duel over animal minds, and one of my favorite memories of this bipolar reaction to claims about animal intelligence occurred at an international scientific workshop on animal intelligence, where one distinguished researcher managed to play both romantic and killjoy roles with equal passion. "Ha! You think insects are so stupid? I'll show you how smart they are. Consider this result." Followed later on the same day by, "So you think bees are so clever? Let me show you how stupid they really are. They're mindless little robots." Peace. We will see that both sides are right about some things and wrong about others. We're not the godlike geniuses we sometimes think we are, but animals are not so smart either, and yet both humans and other animals are admirably equipped to deal brilliantly with many of the challenges thrown at them by a difficult, if not always cruel, world. And our human minds are uniquely powerful in ways that we can begin to understand once we see how they got that way. Why do we care so much? That is one of the many hanging questions that needs an answer, but not right now, except in briefest outline. While the processes that gave rise to this caring go back thousands of years, and in some regards millions or even billions of years, they first became a topic, an object to think about and care about, at the birth of modern science in the 17th century. So that is where I will break into the ring and start this version of the story. The Cartesian Wound. "Si abbiamo un'anima, ma è fatta di tanti piccoli robot." Yes, we have a soul, but it's made of lots of tiny robots. Headline for an interview with me by Giulio Giorello in Corriere della Sera, Milan, 1997. René Descartes, the 17th century French scientist and philosopher, was very impressed with his own mind, for good reason. He called it his res cogitans, or thinking thing, and it struck him, on reflection, as a thing of miraculous competence. If anybody had the right to be in awe of his own mind, Descartes did. He was undoubtedly one of the greatest scientists of all time, with major work in mathematics, optics, physics, and physiology, and the inventor of one of the most valuable thinking tools of all time, the system of Cartesian coordinates that enables us to translate between algebra and geometry, paving the way for calculus and letting us plot almost anything we want to investigate, from aardvark growth to zinc futures. Descartes propounded the original TOE, theory of everything, a prototypical grand unified theory which he published under the immodest title Le Monde, the world. It purported to explain everything from the orbits of the planets and the nature of light to the tides, from volcanoes to magnets, why water forms into spherical drops, how fire is struck from flint, and much, much more. His theory was almost all dead wrong, but it held together surprisingly well and is strangely plausible even in today's hindsight. It took Sir Isaac Newton to come up with a better physics in his famous Principia, an explicit refutation of Descartes' theory. Descartes didn't think it was just his mind that was wonderful. He thought that all normal human minds were wonderful, capable of feats that no mere animal could match, feats that were beyond the reach of any imaginable mechanism, however elaborate and complicated. So he concluded that minds like his and yours were not material entities like lungs or brains, but made of some second kind of stuff that didn't have to obey the laws of physics, articulating the view known as dualism, and often Cartesian dualism. This idea that mind isn't matter and matter can't be mind was not invented by Descartes. It had seemed obvious to reflective people for thousands of years that our minds are not like the furniture of the external world. The doctrine that each of us has an immaterial and immortal soul that resides in and controls the material body long passed for shared knowledge, thanks to the instruction of the Church. But it was Descartes who distilled this default assumption into a positive theory. The immaterial mind, the conscious thinking thing that we know intimately through introspection, is somehow in communication with the material brain, which provides all the input, but none of the understanding or experience. The problem with dualism ever since Descartes is that nobody has ever been able to offer a convincing account of how these postulated interactive transactions between mind and body could occur without violating the laws of physics. The candidates on display today offer us a choice between a revolution in science so radical that it can't be described, which is convenient since critics are standing by ready to pounce, or a declaration that some things are just mysteries beyond human understanding, which is also convenient if you don't have any ideas and want to exit swiftly. But even if, as I noted years ago, dualism tends to be regarded as a cliff over which you push your opponents, those left on the plateau have a lot of unfinished business constructing a theory that is not dualism in disguise. The mysterious linkage between mind and matter has been a battleground of scientists and philosophers since the 17th century. Francis Crick, the recently deceased co-discoverer of the structure of DNA, was another of history's greatest scientists, and his last major piece of writing was The Astonishing Hypothesis, The Scientific Search for the Soul, 1994, in which he argued that dualism is false. The mind just is the brain, a material organ with no mysterious extra properties not found in other living organisms. He was by no means the first to put forward this denial of dualism. It has been the prevailing, but not unanimous, opinion of both scientists and philosophers for the better part of a century. In fact, many of us in the field objected to his title. There was nothing astonishing about this hypothesis. It had been our working assumption for decades. Its denial would be astonishing, like being told that gold was not composed of atoms or that the law of gravity didn't hold on Mars. Why should anyone expect that consciousness would bifurcate the universe dramatically, when even life and reproduction could be accounted for in physico-chemical terms? But Crick wasn't writing his book for scientists and philosophers, and he knew that among lay people, the appeal of dualism was still quite overpowering. It seemed not only obvious to them that their private thoughts and experiences were somehow conducted in some medium in addition to the neuronal spike trains scientists had found buzzing around in their brains, but the prospect of denying dualism threatened horrible consequences as well. If we are just machines, what happens to free will and responsibility? How could our lives have meaning at all if we are just huge collections of proteins and other molecules churning away according to the laws of chemistry and physics? If moral precepts were nothing but extrusions generated by the hordes of microbiological nanomachines between our ears, how could they make a difference worth honoring? Crick did his best to make the astonishing hypothesis not just comprehensible, but also palatable to the lay public. Despite his clear and energetic writing and unparalleled gravitas, he didn't make much progress. This was largely, I think, because in spite of his book's alarm bell of a title, he underestimated the emotional turmoil this idea provokes. Crick was an excellent explainer of science to non-scientists, but the pedagogical problems in this arena are not the usual ones of attracting and holding the attention of semi-bewildered and intimidated laypeople and getting them to work through a smattering of math. When the topic of consciousness arises, the difficult task is to keep a lid on the anxieties and suspicions that seduce people, including many scientists, into distorting what we know and aiming preemptive strikes at dangerous ideas they dimly see looming. Moreover, on this topic, everybody's an expert. People are calmly prepared to be instructed about the chemical properties of calcium or the microbiological details of cancer, but they think they have a particular personal authority about the nature of their own conscious experiences that can trump any hypothesis they find unacceptable. Crick is not alone. Many others have tried their hand at knitting up what one of the best of them, Terence Deacon, has called the Cartesian wound that severed mind from body at the birth of modern science. Their efforts are often fascinating, informative, and persuasive, but no one has yet managed to be entirely convincing. I have devoted half a century, my entire academic life, to the project in a dozen books and hundreds of articles tackling various pieces of the puzzle, without managing to move all that many readers from wary agnosticism to calm conviction. Undaunted, I am trying once again and going for the whole story this time. Why do I think it is worth trying? Because first, I think we have made tremendous scientific progress in the last 20 years. Many of the impressionistic hunches of yore can now be replaced with well-researched details. I plan to rely heavily on the bounty of experimental and theoretical work that others have recently provided. And second, I think I now have a better sense of the various undercurrents of resistance that shackle our imaginations, and I plan to expose and disarm them as we go, so that, for the first time, the doubters can take seriously the prospect of a scientific, materialist theory of their own minds. Cartesian gravity. Over the years, trudging back and forth over the battleground, participating in many skirmishes, I've gradually come to be able to see that there are powerful forces at work, distorting imagination, my own imagination included, pulling us first one way and then another. If you learn to see these forces too, you will find that suddenly things begin falling into place in a new way. You can identify the forces tugging at your thinking, and then set up alarms to alert you and buffers to protect you, so that you can resist them effectively while simultaneously exploiting them, because they are not just distorting, they can also be imagination-enhancing, launching your thinking into new orbits. One cold, starry night over 30 years ago, I stood with some of my Tufts students looking up at the sky, while my friend, the philosopher of science, Paul Churchland, instructed us on how to see the plane of the ecliptic. That is, to look at the other visible planets in the sky and picture them, and ourselves, as wheeling around the sun all on the same invisible plane. It helps to tip your head just so, and remind yourself of where the sun must be, way back behind you. Suddenly, the orientation clicks into place and shazam, you see it. Of course, we all knew for years that this was the situation of our planet in the solar system, but until Paul made us see it, it was a rather inert piece of knowledge. Inspired by his example, I am going to present some eye-opening, actually mind-opening, experiences that I hope will move your mind into some new and delightful places. The original distorting force, which I will call Cartesian gravity, actually gives birth to several other forces, to which I will expose you again and again in different guises, until you can see them clearly too. Their most readily visible manifestations are already familiar to most everyone. Too familiar, in fact, since we tend to think we have already taken their measure. We underestimate them. We must look behind them and beyond them to see the way they tend to sculpt our thinking. Let's begin by looking back at Crick's astonishing hypothesis. Those of us who insist that we don't find it at all astonishing fuel our confidence by reminding ourselves of the majestic array of well-solved puzzles, well-sleuthed discoveries, well-confirmed theories of modern materialistic science that we all take for granted these days. When you think about it, it is just amazing how much we human beings have figured out in the few centuries since Descartes. We know how atoms are structured, how chemical elements interact, how plants and animals propagate, how microscopic pathogens thrive and spread, how continents drift, how hurricanes are born, and much, much more. We know our brains are made of the same ingredients as all the other things we've explained, and we know that we belong to an evolved lineage that can be traced back to the dawn of life. If we can explain self-repair in bacteria and respiration in tadpoles and digestion in elephants, why shouldn't conscious thinking in H. sapiens eventually divulge its secret workings to the same ever-improving, self-enhancing scientific juggernaut? That's a rhetorical question. And trying to answer rhetorical questions instead of being cowed by them is a good habit to cultivate. So might consciousness be more challenging than self-repair or respiration or digestion? And if so, why? Perhaps because it seems so different, so private, so intimately available to each of us in a way unlike any other phenomenon in our living bodies. It is not all that hard these days to imagine how respiration works, even if you're ignorant of the details. You breathe in the air, which we know is a combination of different gases, and we breathe out what we can't use, carbon dioxide, as most people know. One way or another, the lungs must filter out and grab what is needed, oxygen, and exude the waste product, carbon dioxide. Not hard to grasp in outline. The phenomenon of smelling a cookie and suddenly remembering an event in your childhood seems, in contrast, not at all mechanical. Make me a nostalgia machine! What? What could the parts possibly do? Even the most doctrinaire materialists will admit that they have only foggy and programmatic ideas about how brain activities might amount to nostalgia or wistfulness or prurient curiosity, for example. Not so much an astonishing hypothesis, many might admit, as a dumbfounding hypothesis, a hypothesis about which one can only wave one's hands and hope. Still, it's a comfortable position to maintain, and it's tempting to diagnose those who disagree, the self-appointed defenders of consciousness from science, as suffering from one or another ignominious failing. Narcissism? I refuse to have my glorious mind captured in the snares of science. Fear? If my mind is just my brain, I won't be in charge. Life will have no meaning. Or disdain? These simple-minded scientistic reductionists, they have no idea how far short they fall in their puny attempts to appreciate the world of meaning. These diagnoses are often warranted. There is no shortage of pathetic bleats issuing from the mouths of the defenders, but the concerns that motivate them are not idle fantasies. Those who find Crick's hypothesis not just astonishing but also deeply repugnant are onto something important. And there is also no shortage of anti-dualist philosophers and scientists who are not yet comfortable with materialism and are casting about for something in between, something that can actually make some progress on the science of consciousness without falling into either. The trouble is that they tend to misdescribe it, inflating it into something deep and metaphysical. What they are feeling is a way of thinking, an overlearned habit, so well entrenched in our psychology that denying it or abandoning it is literally unthinkable. One sign of this is that the confident scientific attitude expressed by the other side begins to tremble the closer the scientists get to a certain set of issues dealing with consciousness, and they soon find themselves, in spite of themselves, adopting the shunned perspective of the defenders. I am going to describe this dynamic process metaphorically at the outset to provide a simple framework for building a less metaphorical, more explicit, and factual understanding of what is happening. Suppose the would-be mind explainer starts with her own mind. She stands at home, on planet Descartes, meditating on the task ahead and looking at the external universe from the first-person point of view. From this vantage point, she relies on all the familiar furniture of her mind to keep her bearings, and Cartesian gravity is the force that locks her into this egocentric point of view from the inside. Her soliloquy might be, echoing Descartes, "Here I am, a conscious thinking thing, intimately acquainted with the ideas in my own mind, which I know better than anybody else just because they're mine." She cannot help but be a defender of her own home. Meanwhile, from far away comes the scientific explorer of consciousness, approaching planet Descartes confidently, armed with instruments, maps, models, and theories, and starts moving in for the triumphant conquest. The closer she gets, however, the more uncomfortable she finds herself. She is being dragged into an orientation she knows she must avoid, but the force is too strong. As she lands on planet Descartes, she finds herself flipped suddenly into first-person orientation, feet on the ground, but now somehow unable to reach or use the tools she brought along to finish the job. Cartesian gravity is all but irresistible when you get that close to the surface of planet Descartes. How did she get there? And what happened in that confusing last-minute inversion? Strange inversions will be a major theme in this book. There seem to be two competing orientations, the first-person point of view of the defenders and the third-person point of view of the scientists, much like the two ways of seeing the philosopher's favorite illusions, the duck-rabbit and the Necker cube. You can't adopt both orientations at once. The problem posed by Cartesian gravity is sometimes called the explanatory gap, but the discussions under that name strike me as largely fruitless because the participants tend to see it as a chasm, not a glitch in their imaginations. They may have discovered the gap, but they don't see it for what it actually is because they haven't asked how it got that way. By reconceiving of the gap as a dynamic imagination distorter that has arisen for good reasons, we can learn how to traverse it safely or, what may amount to the same thing, make it vanish. Cartesian gravity, unlike the gravity of physics, does not act on things in proportion to their mass and proximity to other massy items. It acts on ideas or representations of things in proportion to their proximity in content to other ideas that play privileged roles in the maintenance of a living thing. What this means will gradually become clear, I hope, and then we can set this metaphorical way of speaking aside as a ladder we have climbed and no longer need to rely on. The idea of Cartesian gravity, as so far presented, is just a metaphor. But the phenomenon I am calling by this metaphorical name is perfectly real, a disruptive force that bedevils and sometimes aids our imaginations, and unlike the gravity of physics, it is itself an evolved phenomenon. In order to understand it, we need to ask how and why it arose on planet Earth. It will take several passes over the same history, with different details highlighted each time, to answer this question. We tend to underestimate the strength of the forces that distort our imaginations, especially when confronted by irreconcilable insights that are undeniable. It is not that we can't deny them. It is that we won't deny them, won't even try to deny them. Practicing on the forces that are easy to identify, species chauvinism, human exceptionalism, sexism, prepares us to recognize more subtle forces at work. In the next chapter, I turn briefly to the very beginning of life on the planet and give a preliminary outline of the story to come, with scant detail, and also tackle one of the first objections that, I predict, will occur to the reader while encountering that outline. I cast evolutionary processes as design processes, processes of research and development, or R&D, and this adaptationist or reverse engineering perspective has long lived under an undeserved cloud of suspicion. Contrary to widespread belief, as we shall see, adaptationism is alive and well in evolutionary biology. 2. Before bacteria and Bach. Why Bach? To get a sound perspective on our history, we actually have to go back to the time before bacteria, before life in any form existed, since some of the demands on getting life going at all send important echoes down the eons to explain features of our minds today. And, before turning to that story, let me pause to draw attention to one word, Bach. I could have chosen from Archaea to Shakespeare, or from E. coli to Einstein, or perhaps from prokaryotes to Picasso, but the alliteration of bacteria to Bach proved irresistible. What about the glaring fact that all the candidates I just considered in my pantheon of great minds are men? What an awkward stumble out of the starting blocks. Do I really want to alienate many listeners at the outset? What was I thinking? I did it on purpose, to provide a relatively mild and simple example of one variety of the gravitational forces of Cartesian gravity we will deal with. If you bristled when you noticed my all-male roster of genius, then good. That means you won't forget that I've taken out a loan on your patience, to be repaid at some later time in the book. Bristling, like any acute emotional reaction from fear to amusement, is a sort of boldface for your memory, making the offending item less likely to be forgotten. At this point, I ask you to resist the urge to launch a preemptive strike. Throughout our journey, we will need to identify uncomfortable facts without indulging in premature explanations or rebuttals. While I delight in having listeners who are not only paying close attention but also way ahead of me, I would much prefer that you bide your time, cutting me some slack, giving me enough rope to hang myself, if you like, instead of trying to derail my attempt at a calm, objective account with your premonitions. So let's stand down, pause, and review a few plain facts, leaving the explanations and refutations for later. It is an obvious fact that although there have been many brilliant women of great attainment, none of them has achieved the iconic status of Aristotle, Bach, Copernicus, Dickens, Einstein. I could easily list a dozen more men in the same league, but try for yourself to think of a great female thinker who could readily displace any of these men in playing the emblematic role in my title. My favorites would be Jane Austen, Marie Curie, Ada Lovelace, and Hypatia of Alexandria. I doubt I've overlooked any obvious candidates, but time will tell. There have not yet been any female superstar geniuses. What might explain this fact? Political oppression? The self-fulfilling sexist prophecies that rob young girls of inspiring role models? Media bias over the centuries? Genes? Please don't jump to conclusions, even if you think the answer is obvious. I don't. We will soon see that genes, though essential players in the history of mind, are nowhere near as important as many like to think. Genes may account for basic animal competence, but genes don't account for genius. Moreover, the traditional view of great human societies owing their greatness to the creative brilliance of some of their inhabitants is, I will try to show, just about backward. Human culture itself is a more fecund generator of brilliant innovations than any troop of geniuses, of either gender. This it achieves by a process of cultural evolution that is as much the author of our finest achievements as any individual thinker is. The very idea that evolution by natural selection might have a foundational role to play in understanding human culture fills some people, even wise and thoughtful people, with loathing. They see human culture as something transcendent, the miraculous endowment that distinguishes us human beings from the beasts, the last bulwark against creeping reductionism, against genetic determinism, against the philistinism they think they see in contemporary science. And in reaction to these culture vultures, there are hard-nosed scientists to whom any appeal to culture smells of mystery-mongering, or worse. When I hear the word culture, I reach for my gun. Now, I must ask both sides to holster their guns and be patient. there is a middle ground that can do justice to the humanities and science at the same time, explaining how human culture got up and running by a process of evolution of cultural items, memes, that invaded human brains the way viruses invade human bodies. Yes, memes have not been shown to be a bad idea, and they will get their day in court in this book. Those on both sides who scoff and hoot at the idea of memes will see that there are good objections to memes, in addition to the flawed refutations that have been uncritically accepted by many who just can't stand the idea. But these good objections point to refinements that save the concept of memes after all. So, whose side am I on? Listeners intent on framing the issue in these terms have missed the point. This polarization of visions, with cheering, hissing spectators egging on the combatants, is just a conveniently obvious first manifestation of the forces I am trying to render visible to all and neutralize. There is much more to come, subtler and more insidious pressures on the thinking of scientists, philosophers, and laypeople alike. Now back to my first pass at the story. How investigating the prebiotic world is like playing chess. The simplest, earliest life form capable of reproducing itself, something like a bacterium, was already a breathtakingly complex and brilliantly designed self-maintaining system. Hang on, did I just give aid and comfort to the intelligent design crowd? No. But how can a good materialist, atheist Darwinian like me, keep a straight face while declaring the earliest reproducing life forms to be brilliantly designed? Hold your fire. A well-known chicken-and-egg problem beloved by the intelligent design folks challenges us to undo the paradox of the origin of life. Evolution by natural selection couldn't get started until there were reproducing things, since there would be no offspring to inherit the best designs, but the simplest reproducing thing is much too complex to arise by mere chance. So, it is claimed, evolution cannot get started without a helping hand from an intelligent designer. This is a defective argument, a combination of misdirection and failure of imagination, as we shall see. But we should concede the truly striking fact that the first concoction of molecules capable of reliably reproducing itself was, must have been, an engineering marvel, composed of thousands of complex parts working together. For researchers working on the origin of life, this poses a straightforward challenge. How could this possibly come about without a miracle? Perhaps an intelligent designer from another galaxy was responsible, but this would just postpone the question and make it harder to address. The way to proceed is clear. Start with the minimal specification for a living, reproducing thing, a list of all the things it has to be able to do, and work backward, making an inventory of the available raw materials, often called the feedstock molecules of prebiotic chemistry, and asking what sequence of possible events could gradually bring together, non-miraculously, all the necessary parts in the right positions to accomplish the job. Notice that this minimal specification lists what the thing must do, a list of functions, not a list of parts and materials. A mousetrap has to trap mice, and a can opener has to open cans, and a living thing has to capture energy and protect or repair itself long enough to reproduce. How could such a living thing possibly arise? If you can answer this question, you win, rather like achieving checkmate in chess. This is a huge undertaking, with many gaps still to fill. But every year there are encouraging breakthroughs. So confidence runs high that the task can be done, the game can be won. There may actually be many ways life could possibly have arisen out of non-life, but finding just one that deserves scientific allegiance, until a better alternative is discovered, would muffle the impossible in principle choir for good. However, finding even one way is a task so daunting that it has fueled the conviction among researchers that even though the processes that must be invoked to create the end product are utterly blind and purposeless, The product itself is not just intricate, but stunningly effective at what it does. A brilliant design. It takes all the ingenuity human reverse engineers can muster to figure out how the thing got assembled. A commentary by Jack Szostak, one of the leading researchers on one of the biggest breakthroughs of recent years, illustrates this attitude perfectly. For 40 years, efforts to understand the prebiotic synthesis of the ribonucleotide building blocks of RNA have been based on the assumption that they must have assembled from their three molecular components: a nucleobase, which can be adenine, guanine, cytosine, or uracil, a ribose sugar, and phosphate. Of the many difficulties encountered by those in the field, the most frustrating has been the failure to find any way of properly joining the pyrimidine nucleobases, cytosine and uracil, to ribose. But Pauner et al. Revived the prospects of the RNA-first model by exploring a pathway for pyrimidine ribonucleotide synthesis in which the sugar and nucleobase emerge from a common precursor. In this pathway, the complete ribonucleotide structure forms without using free sugar and nucleobase molecules as intermediates. This central insight, combined with a series of additional innovations, provides a remarkably efficient solution to the problem of prebiotic ribonucleotide synthesis. Greg Meyer, an evolutionary biologist commenting on this, makes an important point. John Sutherland, one of Pauner's co-authors, and in whose lab the work was done, worked on the problem for 12 years before he found the solution. What if he had given up after 10? Could we have concluded that no synthesis was possible? No. This work demonstrates the futility of all the various sorts of arguments: the arguments from design, the god of the gaps, the argument from personal incredulity, that rely on ignorance as their chief premise. Throughout this book, I will exploit the perspective of reverse engineering, taking on the premise that every living thing is a product of non-mysterious physical processes that gradually brought all the elements together, refining them along the way, and eventually arrived at the working system we observe, or at some hypothesized intermediate system, a stepping stone that would represent clear progress toward the living things we know exist. The cascade of processes must make changes that we can see, in retrospect, to be improvements in the design of the emerging systems. We're on the way to checkmate. Are we making progress? Until there were systems that could be strictly called reproducing systems, the processes at work were only proto-evolutionary, semi-Darwinian, partial analogs of proper evolution by natural selection. They were processes that raised the likelihood that various combinations of ingredients would arise and persist, concentrating the feedstock molecules until this eventually led to the origin of life. A living thing must capture enough energy and materials and fend off its own destruction long enough to construct a good enough replica of itself. The reverse engineering perspective is ubiquitous in biology and is obligatory in investigations of the origin of life. It always involves some kind of optimality considerations. What is the simplest chemical structure that could possibly do X? Or would phenomenon X be stable enough to sustain process Y? In a highly influential essay, Stephen Jay Gould and Richard Lewontin coined the phrase Panglossian paradigm as a deliberately abusive term for the brand of biology, adaptationism, that relies on the methodological principle of assuming, until proven otherwise, that all the parts of an organism are good for something. That is, they have useful roles to play, such as pumping blood, improving speed of locomotion, fending off infection, digesting food, dissipating heat, attracting mates, and so forth. The assumption is built right into the reverse engineering perspective that sees all living things as efficiently composed of parts with functions. There are well-recognized exceptions. For instance, features that used to be good for something and are now vestigial along for the ride unless they are too expensive to maintain, and features that have no actual function but just drifted to fixation by chance. Gould and Lewontin's joke was a recycled caricature. In Candide, Voltaire created Dr. Pangloss, a wickedly funny caricature of the philosopher Leibniz, who had maintained that our world was the best of all possible worlds. In Dr. Pangloss's overfertile imagination, there was no quirk, no deformity, no catastrophe of nature that couldn't be seen in retrospect to have a function, to be a blessing, just what a benevolent God would arrange for us, the lucky inhabitants of the perfect world. Venereal disease, for instance, is indispensable in this best of worlds. For if Columbus, when visiting the West Indies, had not caught this disease, which poisons the source of generation, which frequently even hinders generation, and is clearly opposed to the great end of nature, we should have neither chocolate nor cochineal. Leibniz scholars will insist, with some justice, that Voltaire's parody is hugely unfair to Leibniz, but leave that aside. Was Gould and Lewontin's reuse of the idea an unfair caricature of the use of optimality assumptions in biology? Yes, and it has had two unfortunate effects. Their attack on adaptationism has been misinterpreted by some evolution dreaders as tantamount to a refutation of the theory of natural selection, and it has convinced many biologists that they should censor not only their language but also their thinking, as if reverse engineering was some sort of illicit trick they should shun, if at all possible. Those working on the origin of life have ignored the Pangloss critique of their methods, knowing that their strategic assumptions serve to direct the investigation away from fruitless wandering. There is no point in looking at chemical reactions that couldn't possibly generate a target structure presumed to be a necessary component. Admittedly, there are risks to this strategy, as Zostak notes. For years, the researchers made the mistaken assumption that the obviously best, most efficient way of uniting the nucleobases to the ribose was directly, and they overlooked the more devious path of having the ribonucleotide emerge from a common precursor, without involving the intermediate steps that had seemed necessary. In chess, a gambit is a strategy that gives up material, a step backward it seems, in order to take a better forward step from an improved position. When trying to calculate what your opponent is going to do, gambits are hard to spot, since they seem at first to be losing moves that can be safely ignored, since one's opponent is not that stupid. The same risk of ignoring devious but fruitful trails besets the reverse engineer in biology, since, as Francis Crick famously said, enunciating what he called Orgel's second rule, evolution is cleverer than you are. The uncanny way the blind, purposeless churn of evolution, including prebiotic chemical evolution, uncovers off-the-wall solutions to problems is not evidence for an intelligent designer, nor is it grounds for abandoning reverse engineering, which would mean giving up the inquiry altogether. It is grounds for persisting and improving your reverse engineering game. As in chess, don't give up. Learn from your mistakes and keep on exploring as imaginatively as you can, bearing in mind that your hypotheses, however plausible, still risk disconfirmation, which should be conscientiously sought. Here is an example of a possible gambit in the origin of life. It is initially tempting to assume that the very first living thing capable of reproducing must have been the simplest possible living thing, given the existing conditions on the planet at the time. First things first, make the simplest replicator you can imagine, and then build on that foundation. But this is by no means necessary. It is possible, and more likely, I think, that a rather inelegantly complicated, expensive, slow, Rube Goldberg conglomeration of objets trouvés was the first real replicator, and after it got the replication ball rolling, this ungainly replicator was repeatedly simplified in competition with its kin. many of the most baffling magic tricks depend on the audience not imagining the ridiculously extravagant lengths magicians will go to in order to achieve a baffling effect. If you want to reverse engineer magicians, you should always remind yourself that they have no shame, no abhorrence of bizarre expenditures for tiny effects that they can then exploit. Nature similarly has no shame, and no budget, and all the time in the world. Talk of improvements or progress in the slow, uncertain process of biogenesis is not indulging in illicit value judgments, which have no place in science, let's agree, but is rather an acknowledgement of the ever-present requirements of stability and efficiency in anything living. If you like, you can imagine biochemists working on how something utterly terrible might come into existence, a doomsday device or self-replicating death ray. They would still have to discipline their search by imagining possible paths to construct this horror. And they might well marvel at the brilliance of the design they finally figured out. I will have more to say about the presuppositions and implications of reverse engineering in biology later. Here I hope to forestall premature dismissal of my project by any who has been persuaded, directly or by hearsay, that Gould and Lewontin's propaganda against adaptationism was fatal, contrary to the opinion widely engendered by their famous essay. Adaptationism is alive and well. Reverse engineering, when conducted with due attention to the risks and obligations, is still the royal road to discovery in biology and the only path to discovery in the demanding world of prebiotic chemistry of the origin of life. Next, I want to look at the phenomenon of the origin of life from a more philosophical perspective, as the origin of reasons. Is there design in nature, or only apparent design? If we consider evolutionary biology to be a species of reverse engineering, does this imply that there are reasons for the arrangements of the parts of living things? Whose reasons? Or can there be reasons without a reasoner? Designs without a designer? 3. On the origin of reasons. The death or rebirth of teleology. Darwin is often credited with overthrowing Aristotle's all-too-influential doctrine that everything in the world has a purpose, an end, in the sense that the ends justify the means, or, as the French say, a raison d'être, a reason for being. Aristotle identified four questions we might want to ask about anything. 1. What is it made of, or its material cause? 2. What is its structure, or its formal cause? 3. How did it get started, or what is its efficient cause? 4. What is its purpose, or its final, or telic cause? The Greek for the fourth cause is telos, from which we derive the term teleology. Science, we are often told, has banished the telos, and we have Darwin to thank for this. As Karl Marx once famously put it in his appreciation of Darwin's Origin of Species, "Not only is a death blow dealt here for the first time to teleology in the natural sciences, but their rational meaning is empirically explained." But a closer look shows that Marx is equivocating between two views that continue to be defended. We should banish all teleological formulations from the natural sciences, or, now that we can empirically explain the rational meaning of natural phenomena without ancient ideology of entelechies, intelligent creators, and the like, we can replace old-fashioned teleology with new post-Darwinian teleology. This equivocation is firmly knitted into the practice and declarations of many thoughtful scientists to this day. On the one hand, biologists routinely and ubiquitously refer to the functions of behaviors, such as foraging and territory marking, organs such as eyes and swim bladders, subcellular machinery such as ribosomes, chemical cycles such as the Krebs cycle, and macromolecules such as motor proteins and hemoglobin. But some thoughtful biologists and philosophers of biology are uneasy about these claims, and insist that all this talk of functions and purposes is really only shorthand, a handy metaphor, and that, strictly speaking, there are no such things as functions, no purposes, no teleology at all in the world. Here we see the effect of another of the imagination-distorting forces spawned by Cartesian gravity. So seductive is the lure of Cartesian thinking that, in order to resist it, some think we should follow the abstemious principle that, whenever there is any risk of infection by pre-scientific concepts of souls and spirits, Aristotelian teleology and the like, it is best to err on the side of squeaky clean absolute quarantine. This is often a fine principle. The surgeon excising a tumor takes out a generous margin around the suspect tissue. Political leaders institute buffer zones to keep dangerous weapons or dangerous ideologies at arm's length. A little propaganda can help keep people vigilant. Among the epithets hurled at unrepentant teleologists are Darwinian paranoia and conspiracy theorists. It is, of course, open to defend an intermediate position that forbids certain teleological excesses, but licenses more staid and circumscribed varieties of talk about functions, and philosophers have devised a variety of such views. My informal sense is that many scientists assume that some such sane middle position is in place and must have been adequately defended in some book or article that they probably read years ago. So far as I know, however, no such consensus classic text exists, and many of the scientists who guiltlessly allude to the functions of whatever they are studying still insist that they would never commit the sin of teleology. One of the further forces in operation here is the desire not to give aid and comfort to creationists and the intelligent design crowd. By speaking of purpose and design in nature, we, apparently, give them half their case. It is better, some think, to maintain a stern embargo on such themes and insist that, strictly speaking, nothing in the biosphere is designed unless it is designed by human artificers. Nature's way of generating complex systems, organs, behaviors, etc., is so unlike an artificer's way that we should not use the same language to describe them. Thus, Richard Dawkins speaks, on occasion, of designoid features of organisms, and in The Ancestor's Tale he says, "The illusion of design conjured by Darwinian natural selection is so breathtakingly powerful." I disagree with this overkill austerity, which can backfire badly. A few years ago, I overheard some Harvard Medical School students in a bar marveling at the intricacies to be found in the protein machinery inside a cell. One of them exclaimed, "How could anybody believe in evolution in the face of all that design?" The others did not demur, whatever their private thoughts. Why would anyone say that? Evolutionists aren't embarrassed by the intricacy of nature. They revel in it. Discovering and explaining the evolution of the intracellular complexities that govern the life of a cell has been one of the glories of evolutionary microbiology in recent years. But this fellow's remark suggests that one of the themes gaining ground in common understanding is that evolutionary biologists are reluctant to admit or acknowledge the manifest design in nature. People should know better, especially medical students. Consider, in this regard, Christoph Schönborn, Catholic Archbishop of Vienna, who was seduced by the intelligent design folks into denying the theory of natural selection on the grounds that it couldn't explain all the design. He said, notoriously, in a New York Times op-ed piece entitled "Finding Design in Nature," "The Catholic Church, while leaving to science many details about the history of life on earth, proclaims that by the light of reason, the human intellect can readily and clearly discern purpose and design in the natural world, including the world of living things. Evolution in the sense of common ancestry might be true, but evolution in the neo-Darwinian sense, an unguided, unplanned process of random variation and natural selection, is not. Any system of thought that denies or seeks to explain away the overwhelming evidence for design in biology is ideology, not science." Which battle do we want to fight? Do we want to try to convince lay people that they don't really see the design that is stunningly obvious at every scale in biology? Or would we rather try to persuade them that what Darwin has shown is that there can be design, real design, as real as it gets, without an intelligent designer? We have persuaded the world that atoms are not atomic, and that the Earth goes around the Sun. Why shrink from the pedagogical task of showing that there can be design without a designer? So I am defending here, once again with new emphasis, the following claim. The biosphere is utterly saturated with design, with purpose, with reasons. What I call the design stance predicts and explains features throughout the living world using the same assumptions that work so well when reverse engineering artifacts made by somewhat intelligent human designers. There are three different but closely related strategies or stances we can adopt when trying to understand, explain, and predict phenomena: the physical stance, the design stance, and the intentional stance. The physical stance is the least risky, but also the most difficult. You treat the phenomenon in question as a physical phenomenon, obeying the laws of physics, and use your hard-won understanding of physics to predict what will happen next. The design stance works only for things that are designed, either artifacts or living things or their parts, and have functions or purposes. The intentional stance works primarily for things that are designed to use information to accomplish their functions. It works by treating the thing as a rational agent, attributing beliefs and desires and rationality to the thing, and predicting that it will act rationally. Evolution by natural selection is not itself a designed thing, an agent with purposes, but it acts as if it were. It occupies the role vacated by the intelligent designer. It is a set of processes that find and track reasons for things to be arranged one way rather than another. The chief difference between the reasons found by evolution and the reasons found by human designers is that the latter are typically, but not always, represented in the minds of the designers, whereas the reasons uncovered by natural selection are represented for the first time by those human investigators who succeed in reverse engineering nature's productions. Dawkins's title, The Blind Watchmaker, nicely evokes the apparently paradoxical nature of these processes. On the one hand, they are blind, mindless, without goals, and on the other hand, they produce designed entities galore, many of which become competent artificers, nest builders, web spinners, and so forth, and a few become intelligent designers and builders, us. Evolutionary processes brought purposes and reasons into existence the same way they brought color vision, and hence colors, into existence, gradually. If we understand the way our human world of reasons grew out of a simpler world where there were no reasons, we will see that purposes and reasons are as real as colors, as real as life. Thinkers who insist that Darwin has banished teleology should add, for consistency's sake, that science has also demonstrated the unreality of colors and of life itself. Atoms are all there is, and atoms aren't colored, and aren't alive either. How could mere large conglomerations of uncolored, unalive things add up to colored live things? This is a rhetorical question that should be and can be answered eventually. Now I want to defend the claim that there are reasons for what proteins do, and there are reasons for what bacteria do, what trees do, what animals do, and what we do. And there are colors as well, of course, and yes, Virginia, life really exists. Different senses of why. Perhaps the best way of seeing the reality, indeed the ubiquity in nature, of reasons is to reflect on the different meanings of why. The English word is equivocal, and the main ambiguity is marked by a familiar pair of substitute phrases, what for and how come. Why are you handing me your camera? Asks, what are you doing this for? Why does ice float? Asks, how come? what it is about the way ice forms that makes it lower density than liquid water. The how come question asks for a process narrative that explains the phenomenon without saying it is for anything. Why is the sky blue? Why is the sand on the beach sorted by size? Why did the ground just shake? Why does hail accompany thunderstorms? Why is this dry mud cracked in such a fashion? And also, why did this turbine blade fail? Some folks might wish to treat the question of why ice floats as inviting a what-for reason, God's reason, presumably, for this feature of the inanimate world. I guess God wanted fish to be able to live under the ice in the winter, and if ponds froze from the bottom up, this would be hard on the fish. But as long as we have an answer to the how-come question, in terms of physics and chemistry, it really would be something like paranoia to ask for more. Compare four questions. 1. Do you know the reason why planets are spherical? 2. Do you know the reason why ball bearings are spherical? 3. Do you know the reason why asteroids aren't spherical? 4. Do you know the reason why dice aren't spherical? The word reason is acceptable in all four questions, at least to my ear. How about yours? But the answers to 1 and 3 don't give reasons. There aren't any reasons. They give causes or process narratives. In some contexts, the word reason can mean cause, unfortunately. You can answer questions 2 and 4 with process narratives along the lines of, well, the ball bearings were made on a lathe of sorts which spun the metal, and the dice were cast in box-like molds. But those are not reasons. Sometimes people confuse the different questions, as in a memorable exchange that occurred in a debate I had with an ardent champion of Skinnerian behaviorism, Lou Michaels, at Western Michigan University in 1974. I had presented my paper, Skinner Skinned, in Brainstorms, and Michaels, in his rebuttal, delivered a particularly bold bit of behaviorist ideology, to which I responded, "But why do you say that, Lou?" To which his instant reply was, "Because I have been rewarded for saying that in the past." I was demanding a reason, a what for, and getting a process narrative, a how come, in reply. There is a difference, and the Skinnerians' failed attempt to make it go away should alert positivistically minded scientists that they pay a big price in understanding if they try to banish what for. The first two sentences of this book are, how come there are minds? And how is it possible for minds to ask and answer this question? It is asking for a process narrative, and that is what I am going to provide. But it will be a process narrative that also answers the questions, how come there are what for questions, and what are what for questions for? The evolution of why from how come to what for. Evolution by natural selection starts with how come and arrives at what for. We start with a lifeless world in which there are no reasons, no purposes at all, but there are processes that happen. Rotating planets, tides, freezing, thawing, volcanic eruptions, and gazillions of chemical reactions. Some of those processes happen to generate other processes that happen to generate other processes until at some point, but don't look for a bright line, we find it appropriate to describe the reasons why some things are arranged as they now are. Why do we find it appropriate, and how did we get into that state of mind? Patience, the answer to that will come soon. A central feature of human interaction, and one of the features unique to our species, is the activity of asking others to explain themselves, to justify their choices and actions, and then judging, endorsing, rebutting their answers in recursive rounds of the why game. Children catch on early and often overdo their roles trying the patience of their parents. Why are you sawing the board? I'm making a new door. Why are you making a new door? So we can close the house up when we go out. Why do you want to close the house up when we go out? Why don't we want strangers taking our things? Why do we have things? The fluency with which we all engage in this mutual reason checking testifies to its importance in conducting our lives. Our capacity to respond appropriately in this reason checking activity is the root of responsibility. Those who cannot explain themselves or cannot be moved by the reasons offered by others, those who are deaf to the persuasions of advisors, are rightly judged to be of diminished responsibility and are treated differently by the law. The activity of demanding and evaluating each other's reasons for action does not occupy our every waking hour, but it does play a major role in coordinating our activities, initiating the young into their adult roles, and establishing the norms by which we judge one another. So central is this practice to our own way of life that it is sometimes hard to imagine how other social species, dolphins, wolves, and chimpanzees, for instance, can get along without it. How do the juveniles learn their place, for instance, without being told their place? How do elephants settle disagreements about when to move on or where to go next? Subtle instinctual signals of approval and disapproval must suffice, and we should also remember that no other species engages in the level of complex cooperative behaviors that we, human beings, have achieved. Wilfred Sellers, a philosopher at the University of Pittsburgh, described this activity of reasoning with one another as creating or constituting the logical space of reasons, and inspired a generation of Pittsburgh philosophers, led by Robert Brandom and John Hoglund, to explore this arena in detail. What are the permissible moves, and why? How do new considerations enter the space, and how are transgressions dealt with? The space of reasons is bound by norms, by mutual recognition of how things ought to go, the right way, not the wrong way, to play the reason-giving game. Wherever there are reasons, then, there is room for and a need for some kind of justification and the possibility of correction when something goes wrong. This normativity is the foundation of ethics. The ability to appreciate how reason-giving ought to go is a prerequisite for appreciating how life in society ought to go. Why and how did this practice and its rules arise? It hasn't existed forever, but it exists now. How come and what for? The Pittsburgh philosophers have not addressed this question, asking how it got that way, so we will have to supplement their analysis with some careful speculation of our own on the evolution of the reason-giving game. I will try to show that ignoring this question has led the Pittsburgh philosophers to elide the distinction between two different kinds of norms and their associated modes of correction, which I will call social normativity and instrumental normativity. The former, analyzed and celebrated at Pittsburgh, is concerned with the social norms that arise within the practice of communication and collaboration. Hence, Hoglund, 1998, speaks of the censoriousness of members of society as the force that does the correcting. The latter is concerned with quality control or efficiency, the norms of engineering, you could say, as revealed by market forces or by natural failures. This is nicely illustrated by the distinction between a good deed and a good tool. A good deed might be clumsily executed and even fail in its purpose, while a good tool might be an efficient torture device or evil weapon. We can see the same contrast in negative cases, in the distinction between naughty and stupid. People may punish you for being naughty, by their lights, but nature itself may mindlessly punish you for being stupid. As we shall see, we need both kinds of norms to create the perspective from which reasons are discernible in nature. Reason appreciation did not co-evolve with reasons the way color vision co-evolved with color. Reason appreciation is a later, more advanced product of evolution than reasons. Wherever there are reasons, an implicit norm may be invoked. Real reasons are supposed always to be good reasons, reasons that justify the feature in question. No demand for justification is implied by any how-come question. When we reverse engineer a newly discovered artifact, for instance, we may ask why there is a conspicuous...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.